gentlemen. My name is Richard McDonald. I'm not a citizen of the United States, and I'm not a U.S. citizen. What I am is a Californian. That is defined in the Federal Style Manual, Section 5.23, Title 8, Sections 1101A21. Also, everybody get your paper and pencil handy, because I got a few things I want you to write down tonight. Write this down, Handbook of Elementary Law, 1939, by McGray, M-C-G-R-A-Y. And I'm going to read you just a little bit out of it. And you'll understand where the federal government is coming from, where the state government is coming from. This book was published in 1939. In 1941, right after this book was published, California changed their laws to comply with this book. They said, prior to 1939, it says everybody has a domicile. In 1941, they took it and said the word domicile out and replaced it with residence. Okay? Now listen what the court, the law book says. The members of a state. A member of a state may be either a citizen occupying the status called entitled citizenship, or he may be a resident alien occupying the status designated by the title residence. So when you have a residence, you are now occupying a specific title as a resident alien. And there's several court cases that say the same thing. U.S. v. Slater says the same thing. They treat each state in the Union as a foreign country on the same equivalent status as of Mexico for prosecuting you. You're in a foreign country. They're very consistent. But I've been saying that residence was a nasty word, but I didn't know why. I knew what it meant. But I didn't know they had a law that supported what I did until just recently. You know, let me reread that again. A member of a state may be either a citizen occupying the status called citizenship, which I have, or he may be a resident alien occupying the status designated by the title resident.
There's no third option.
They knew exactly what they were doing when they put those words in there. So that's why everybody has a residence. I don't have a residence. I have a home. Certain keywords you must always use. You have a home. You have land. Don't have property. You have land. You have several different things. But one of the key things is that you don't use those nasty words. And why should we be state citizens? Because as a state citizen, you are sovereign. You have the absolute right to work if you know how to exercise it. You have the absolute right to do anything you want to do as long as you don't hurt somebody else. I can't hurt him, her. But what I can do, I can hurt the government all I want because they have no rights. The government is without any rights whatsoever. And I can prove that to you in several different case law scenarios, which we'll get to eventually. One of the key things I want to explain to you is that you can do it. How many people have read the paper last week about the deputy up in Ventura County suing because he's suing the county of Ventura because he wants the Social Security number taken off for maintaining false records? Okay? Can be done. There's a lady in Michigan right now that's suing the workplace. She went to work for this company, and she worked 5 months for this company without a Social Security number. Then they fired her. She has three different paycheck stubs with different Social Security numbers that they created and made up for her, which is a felony. So when you understand, that's what she's doing. So her case is worth $100,000. Just because they maintained false records, they made phony Social Security numbers, they violated every law in the books. We got court cases that say this. Now, how well she carries it off, that's, I just heard about, so I'm just passing along to you that what information is available to you, okay? One of the key things when you do a suit against your employer, if you're working for them, if you're not working for them, makes no difference. You do your request for admissions. You do your interrogatories. You do everything you need to do to comply with the law. You obey the law. And you force them to obey the law. They have to obey the law. There's no law requiring any place that I've been able to find, even I have a letter from the Congressional Research Service that says there's no law requiring anybody to have a Social Security number. If you're not required to have one, why did you get one? My mother got mine. I didn't know. I was little Todd, you know. Most everybody didn't sign their own Social Security number. It was gotten for them by their parents. So you have the right to cancel that contract. And it is a contract for benefits. They may not, they'll say it's not, but it is. It's an application for benefits. And any application is a contract. Yes? Yes. I don't want anything from the federal government because I don't want them in my hip pocket for the rest of my life. I don't want anything. And anything you paid into Social Security, you can get back if you want to get it back. Yes, you can get it back. But there's only one specific way you can do it. And there's people that have done it. But you have to be prepared to go all the way. You don't start a battle and then turn tail and run at the last minute. You know what I mean? Just be prepared to move forward all the way down the line. You have to file in a court of claims. And then if you prevail at the court of claims, then you will automatically get all the income tax money since day one refunded back to you, plus interest. Because the government's wrote many letters stating if you don't have a Social Security number, you would have no taxable income. When you got your Social Security number, how many people were told you were giving up your sovereignty? How many people were told you're giving up all your rights? How many people were told that you were giving up your right of inheritance? How many people told you giving up the right to work to accept a privilege? You know what I mean? How many people were told that when you got your Social Security number, you were asking for government supervision? How many people were told when you got your Social Security number, you'd pay 52% of your salary for the rest of your life to the government? Yes. Three to 5 years, depending on how well. One guy in Florida did it, took him 9 months. Guy followed him up, took him 4 years. You know what I mean? Followed the same suit, you know what I mean? Depends on how you set your case up. You have to set them up. You do your letter writing campaign, you follow me? And you do this, and you do that. You set them up so that you have all the evidence on your side. And once you have them set up, then you can move forward. Okay. I was going to talk about citizenship a lot tonight, so I brought my big book on citizenship. I was going to talk a lot about citizenship. This book here, which I'll be taking to Texas with me next month, how many people have heard of the U.S. Constitution? There's dirt under my feet. It doesn't apply to me. I got several court cases say the U.S. Constitution doesn't apply except to the federal government. It doesn't apply to the state government. It only applies to the state government through the 14th Amendment. So anytime you use the U.S. Constitution, then you are accepting the benefits and privileges of the 14th Amendment. Unless you're in federal court. If you're in federal court, then you can use it all the way down the line. But in state court, you cannot, unequivocally, you cannot use the U.S. Constitution. Steve knows what I'm talking about.
I was going to say, by extension, you wouldn't want to use federal case citations and such either.
No, you don't use federal cases in state court, because that also brings in the 14th Amendment. It only applies to the 14th Amendment.
But they'll drag you there.
Oh, yeah, yes, they will. They'll try to drag you over there. One of the key things you have to learn and remember is that the courts have all said that the state constitution is the sky's the limit on your rights. The federal constitution is the floor. So you want the bare basics or you want the unlimited side? So use the state constitution. They don't like it when you use the state constitution because they know where you're going. They can't overrule the state constitution. In fact, our California Supreme Court, in several cases in the past few years, have overturned the United States Supreme Court. Because the state, based upon the state constitution, they can reverse the United States Supreme Court. And the United States Supreme Court, what they say? We can't touch the case. It's on the state constitution. So you use the state constitution all the time. And you have the ceiling. You know what I mean? Your rights are unlimited under the state constitution. Because the state constitution was written as a restriction and limitation on the state government. The U.S. Constitution was written as a restriction and limitation on the federal government. So when you understand the proper application of the constitutions, you can distinguish them out. Do you follow me? And just apply them appropriately on either side, whichever way is appropriate. There are several good court cases. How many people heard the word state? Yeah, a few people raised their hand. Some people didn't have never heard the word state. State has two separate and legal meanings, depending on how it's used. And the case that they all qualify and state and refer to is Texas versus White, United States Supreme Court, 1862. In that court case, the United States Supreme Court stated, a small s state consists of land, people, and government. A capital S state occupies the land and has people and government. What occupies can be removed, but consists of, small s is consists of. Just like this writing on this paper here, it occupies this paper. I can take a pencil and erase it off. You follow me? But the paper itself is the small s state. It consists of, you know, to create this paper, consists of people, government, and land. So when they say the small s state, that's a fiction created by the people. So it's always a small s state. I live in a small s state. I'm not subject to the capital S state. I'm subject to all the laws created by the small s state, because that's what we the people created. So knowing the distinction, you know, someplace along the line, somebody's going to ask you a question, you know what I mean? Are you subject to state laws? Define state. Are you subject to this? Define what you mean. What they've done a marvelous job, and I have to thank the government, they did a marvelous job. They have multiple meanings for all the words. They did. They have their own specific meaning, legal meaning, that they use against you. Like the best one I can think of off the top of my head, without going to my notes, is the word employee. Employee has five different meanings in the dictionary. Number one, one who works for somebody. Number five, one who works for the federal government. So when you sign a W-4, it's an admission you work for the federal government, as this definition down here, subject to all federal laws. It's just that simple. They don't tell you that, because you think it's this one up here. When you sign an employment application, it's this definition up here. When you sign that W-4, you now switch to this definition down here. And it was redefined in 1939 under, write this down, the 1939 Public Salary Tax Act. It redefined the term employee to mean federal government worker. Very simple. They always tell you the truth consistently.
What's the Texas White citation?
I don't know. It's 1862. I can't remember it off the top of my head. Maybe in the back of this book here. Let me see if I can find it for you here.
U.S. Supreme Court?
Yeah, United States Supreme Court. U.S. 74, 227. Repeating, 74 U.S. 227. That's Texas versus White. So when you understand these definitions, you always ask a question. You say you get a traffic ticket. What's the first thing you do? I did a little scenario because I keep getting, people are always calling me and asking me, what do I do? I got a traffic ticket. When do you go to court?
Tomorrow.
I go to court at 8 o'clock in the morning. This is 9 o'clock at night they call me. Can you help me? I says, yeah. Gwen plead guilty, pay the fine. That's what I tell them. You can't help them. Too late. But this is what you do when you get a ticket. Just a brief scenario I typed up. First thing you do is you file a special demur or a bill of particulars. Say you can't enter a plea because you don't understand the meanings of the words. Okay. Two. Then you file a request for interrogatories. You can file as many sets as you want, 30 questions at a time. Don't go overboard, but they'll scream bloody murder. They like to scream bloody murder. But don't worry about it. Then you can file requests for admissions. You can file as many sets as you want, 30 admissions at one time. You can do 35, but I don't like to. I like to keep it down low. You know what I mean? I have an avenue out. You know what I mean? Then after you hit him with all this paperwork, then you call a prosecutor on the phone. Remember, you're the boss. Who's the boss? You, not them. Call the prosecutor and ask him when you can expect answers to the interrogatories and admissions. If he says he will not answer them, you file a motion to compel him to answer, then ask for another extension so you can have all the discovery done prior to trial. If the court denies the motion to compel, then ask for continuance to file a writ of mandate in the upper court to compel discovery. And California is very strict on discovery. When you read the discovery rules, they're very, very strict. They will adhere to it right away. Okay? After he answers, you get all the discovery you want. Then you can file a request for stipulated facts. Have him sign it and you find it, all his answers. Stipulate to the fact that a motor vehicle is a commercial vehicle. Stipulate to the fact that a driver means commercial activity. You know what I mean? An operator in 1958 meant a private citizen traveling. In 1959, it meant a commercial operator. That's when they combined them, 1959. Stipulate to all these facts. Now, the judge can't deviate from those facts. You see how you're boxing the judge in where he can't go anyplace? Because you've boxed him in already. He has to rule according to the facts presented there, okay? Then once you got your stipulated facts signed by the prosecutor, you follow me? Then you go up and slam dunk the prosecutor again. You file all your judicial notices to the court. You file 30, 40 of them you want. To have the court take judicial notice that I'm not a human being. Human being's a monster, according to the dictionary. So I'm not a monster. Excuse me. I'm a man. You're either man or woman. That's the only two words you can describe me. Or anybody in this room is either man or woman. They're not male or not female. They're man or woman. Male and female has some, different connotations. Then on the trial day, first thing all, Your Honor, before we proceed, there's several judicial notices that the court has to address before we can move further. And the first argument up is the Nisi Prius argument. Let me spell that for you. N-I-S-I Prius, P-R-I-U-S. It's a Nisi Prius argument. See, all courts in this land are Nisi Prius courts. They're contract courts. And we had a judge agree that he is a contract court. That's what Darius's case up in Santa Barbara. So then you stand firm. Okay, Mr. Prosecutor, prove your case. Prove the contract. Make him prove the contract. If you can't prove the contract, you can't move forward. We can't address anything else, Your Honor, until if the prosecutor wants a continuance, I'm willing to accept a continuance and let him prove the contract. Do you follow me? Or in the alternative, he can move to dismiss and I'll accept that. But stand firm there. If the judge overrules you, say, I'm not going to allow this. Thank you, Your Honor. I request a continuance. I want to appeal this denial of the judicial notice because you're denying me due process. Take it upstairs. You know what I mean? Every time he denies you, stop him right there and say, you'd like a continuance. You want to take it upstairs to get the court to recognize what he has to do. You know what I mean? So it takes you 2 years. Steve's been 3 years on one ticket right now. But it's the only way you're going to get the courts to follow the law. You have to make them obey the law. But you have to box them in so they have no place to go. And your Nisi Prius arguments is one of the best ones of all. Now here's a court case. It's an unpublished court case. I want you to write this down. In the First Appellate District up in the city of San Francisco. The Superior Court number 960479. Repeating, Superior Court 960479, City and County of San Francisco. It's a very good IRS case. This is cases. It's Caswell versus Pratt. Caswell versus Pratt. Pratt. In this, like Mr. Tejeda formed a trust. He put all his property in trust. Okay. And then after he put all his property in trust, the IRS came after him, and they had a lien on him before he put his property in trust. So after he put his property in trust, they continued sending him notices. You follow me? Then they sold his home. And then the trust went to court and appealed that Mr. Caswell was not had no interest in the home, because it would belong to the trust. He had sold it to the trust. And the trust assumed liability of the lien on it. And therefore, the trust was not notified of the sale and the lien being activated. And therefore, it was false sale. And the court ruled, yeah, that's correct. The trust has to be notified and served. And they reversed the sale and gave the trust the home again. Huh? No. This is just a straight action. This is straight action in court. They gave you a case number on you, so you can go right up to up on the internet. I think you can get it up there because that's where I got it from, the internet. It's an unpublished case. But everybody has to be notified. He also made allegations he didn't ever receive proper notices. You know what I mean? The court didn't address those because they just invalidated the sale and gave the home back to the trust. See, if the trust is not notified, they can't do it. The trust must be notified. It's a state case that overturned the IRS. It's a state case. It's not a federal case. If you win the federal court, he would have lost. But the state case, he won. Linda Caswell won this issue. You didn't hear about that case, did you, Glenn?
You're going to find it.
Okay. That's one of the... I do a little bit of research once in a while. Most people don't believe me, but I do. You know what I mean? Oh, let's see. Where is it? How many people have heard of the United States? Which one? This has three separate legal meanings. Which one are you talking about? Okay. Well, I'm calling the... Let's see where it is in the middle of this thing. In this case, I can't find it real quick. Like, the court said, the United States Supreme Court in Hooven versus Elliott. No, that's the wrong one. It's Hooven versus Evatt. It's on the Patriot newsletter over there. Hooven versus Evatt. H-O-O-V-E-N versus Evatt. E-V-A-T-T. You can get the direct quote off the paperwork over there. In there, the United States Supreme Court held that the United States has three separate, distinct legal meanings. One, it means a nation amongst nations under international law. One, it means the District of Columbia and the territories over which the United States is sovereign. And the other one, it means the collective name of the sovereign states and the federal government included. The collective name. Which one are they? Which one's bringing charges against me? You do your admissions. I don't understand the meaning. The court says this. You write them a letter and say, the court says this. I want to know which meaning of the United States you're talking about here. Then they got to come back and tell you. Do your request for admissions. And if you want to be really, really nasty, I can teach you to do that too. You file, write a letter to the government, and first you write your first letter to the CRS. That's Congressional Research Service in Washington, D.C. And you ask them, are the Reconstruction Acts, have they ever been repealed? They can write back and say, no, they've never been repealed. Then you write them a second letter. If that's the case, under the Reconstruction Acts, all the states lost their sovereignty. And we're now federal territories and federal enclaves under the Reconstruction Acts under martial law. Is that correct? And they can write back and tell you yes. You don't put all your eggs in one basket. Then you write in the second letter. The third letter, I mean. Then you say, is the president signing these executive orders as he's signing them under the authority of the Reconstruction Acts, under martial law? And they'll say yes. Now you got them. You take those three letters, you... IRS come after you, or you want to go after them, or whatever, bingo. We're under martial law, you know what I mean? The wartime footing. See, you set them up. You do one step at a time. You do a letter writing campaign. Steve knows pretty well how I do letter writing campaign. Very effective, aren't they?
Yes, they are.
When you do your setups one by one by one, you have a, you got a workplace. You write them a letter. Say, I've changed my political status from a U.S. citizen to a Californian. Please collect your records to reflect this. They don't do it, then you write them a second letter. 30 days later, you write them a third letter. Now you can take them into court and make them correct the records. But you have to be prepared to do all that. Do you follow me? You don't write the first letter and say, okay, I lost. You know what I mean? They ignored me. Well, naturally, they're going to ignore you up front. I got a lady who followed my directions, and I got her a job at the Great Western Bank over here in the heart of the beast, mankind's enemy, the banks, at Great Western Bank without a Social Security number. Took her 6 weeks to get the job. But she followed my directions. She wrote letters, wrote the legal department. Every 3 days, she'd write the legal department another letter. Just keep that paperwork going. You follow me? And she just laid so much paper on, they say, we give up, you're hired. She started off $50,000 a year. She worked for almost 5 years before they sold Great Western Bank, then they laid her off. They abolished her position when they combined with other banks. You know what I mean? Of course, they laid off another 5,000 people too, but she just happened to be in the avenue. So it's available to you, yes.
Regarding the Reconstruction Act, the idea is we're operating under martial law.
No, you don't say that. You ask them to say that.
And once they say that,
you're home free.
Because
yes, now, you know what I mean? Oh, we're not under martial law, then the president's executive orders don't apply here.
Well, you just said that we are.
I didn't say that.
The Congressional Research Service said
that. Right.
So, when the president signs an executive order,
he's signing it under the authority of the Reconstruction Act.
Does that apply to?
He's not allowed to. He can't write an executive order and make it apply in Japan. He can't write an executive order and make it apply in Canada. He can't write an executive order and make it apply in Mexico. He can't make an executive order and make it apply in the sovereign state of California, but he can write an executive order and make it apply in Puerto Rico, Guam, the territories, or
military bases,
and etc. You know what I mean?
I think maybe where the breakdown in communication is coming is, I think what Richard is saying is that once you have the proof or the admission that the Reconstruction Act is still alive and well and that martial law is extant, that they are not going to stand up publicly and say, well, yes, of course, we're all under martial law. So rather than make that admission, they're going to back down.
They'll just turn tail and run.
So you get a settlement, you know, rather than an outright victory.
Yeah.
But it amounts to the same thing.
Well, it's just the evidence that, yes, the federal government is operating under martial law.
Yeah. Well, they're not going to say that in court.
Well, the mere fact that if you've gotten these kind of letters, it sounds like great evidence to keep them away.
They'll stay away.
Go home. There you go. Because they don't want this kind of information to see the light of day, I would think.
Right, they don't. This is why you build your... That's why I say you do your letter writing campaign. You build a foundation. You don't... Do not jump off the Golden State Bridge unless you learn how to swim first. You lay a foundation for everything you do. Unless you want to kill yourself, you know what I mean? And I've seen a lot of patriots out there try to kill themselves. They're not ready and they go out there and take their driver's license. When I first started these seminars, I've been doing them here in a hotel since, 92? No, 94. Been doing them here, the earthquake. When I moved here, right after the earthquake, in February '94, second month I was here, I had a nice crowd talking about traveling around, no driver's license, no registration, no insurance, because as a citizen, we're not required to register our household goods. And I had a guy walk out here in the parking lot, take his plates off, and he didn't get down to the first light before he got stopped by the police. Then he come crying to me. He said, cop asked me where my plates were. I says, I don't need them, so I took them off and put them in the trunk of the car. Guess what? He got a ticket. They didn't impound it. He still had a driver's license in his pocket. As long as you got that driver's license in your pocket, you got to get that car registered. Because it's prima facie evidence. Not prima facie, it's, what do they call it? It's a rebuttable presumption that you're a resident and an enemy alien here in California. A resident alien to have a driver's license in your pocket. Rebuttable presumption of. Don't do emotion, okay? Law. Read the law. The law says rebuttable presumption. You follow me? Stick with the law. You never go wrong. See, if you step off and put your own words into the law, the judge is going to come down on you like a house of fire. You follow me?
The word consent is from the California codes.
No, not from the vehicle code.
Not from the vehicle code, no.
No. We're talking about the vehicle code. See?
I found some code sites that state that one, retaining a registration,
yeah,
a pink slip, that sort of thing, it implies a consent on the part of the resident,
yeah,
to be governed by or regulated by.
Yeah. It's 17459 and 17460 of the vehicle code. I know those by heart. See, under the 17459 and 17460 of the vehicle code, the mere possession or retention of a driver's license gives the state power of attorney over you. That's why they can enter a plea for you.
Which raises a question.
You get a ticket.
Yeah.
You're arraigned. And you decide to make life difficult for the arraignment commissioner by demurring or doing any one of a number of things that we do. And the commissioner rolls over you and refuses to honor the demur, denies it even when there's no prosecutor there to oppose your argument. You could go up right then, couldn't you?
You could, but what I would do, and the commissioner would more than likely enter a plea for you at that time.
She did.
Okay, then what I would have done with my current knowledge, you know what I mean? I learn something new every day, you know what I mean? If I don't learn something new every day, I'm going to commit suicide. So I'm still alive, so I'm learning something new every day. I would file a motion to the court to withdraw the plea because the court lacked power of attorney to enter a plea for me. Now, how are they going to overcome that?
Well, then, in that case,
the prosecutor would have to appear to argue the other side of the issue, wouldn't he?
I rest my case.
Well, bring me the contract.
Bring me the contract. We're right back in there again. You follow me? You're playing round robin with them. They try to go over here, you slap them, make them go over here. Come over here, slap them, make them go over there. Come over there, slap them, make them bounce back and forth. You know what I mean? Because you remember, you're the controlling the party. You have the computer, you have the knowledge, you have the brains. You follow me? The judge up there, he's supposed to be a neutral arbitrator. Anytime he's not neutral, you do a 170.0 on him, or 170.3. Yes. That's a civil code section. No, it's civil code, isn't it?
Yeah.
Civil code section, 170.3.
No. CCP.
Civil code of procedure, CCP, 170.3. With that one, you can disqualify every judge in the state of California. No judge can hear your case. In fact, we did it one time, and they went over to Nevada and brought a judge in on the FTP case. Disqualified every judge in the state of California. They went over and got a retired judge out of Nevada to hear the case. They gave a special appointment to him. And he did it pro bono so he wouldn't be paid. So any judge, say you're up on a tax case. Any judge who files an income tax return cannot sit on your case because he's biased. If it's an FTP case in state court and he pays state income tax, the judge, he can't sit on a state income tax case if you know how to do the argument. Well, I have paperwork on that. It can be done, but most people don't want to do that. It's a very hard argument. It's already done on the BBS. In fact, you got it on your hard drive. You know, like I tell Steve all the time, he's got it on his hard drive. He calls me up and says, "What's this? Hey, you can read your hard drive."
F5, F4.
What, did you run out of...
Of already having established state sovereignty?
Pardon?
Do the strategies you're talking about here depend upon you having first established state sovereignty?
Right. No, you have to be a state citizen first before the state can be sovereign. State cannot be sovereign unless it has its own sovereign citizens.
Individual sovereignty. Can you talk briefly about the process you would do to...
Well, I have a citizenship program that I have. You know what I mean? And it consists of a citizenship kit, which you get. It's a manual with all the proper forms and all the documents. You follow me? And then you get four books of compiled court cases, which you must read so you understand the meanings of the words. Do you know how many definitions of the word residence are? The word resident is. There's 758 different meanings of the word resident. What are you talking about? You know what I mean? See, once you understand the formula they're operating by, that's all I do is teaching you formulas. The formula you operate, you can send and ask on legitimate questions. You know what the court says? The term resident has not a technical meaning. In every law, it means something different. And one law includes citizens, next law doesn't include citizens. You know what I mean? In this law, it includes only aliens. In this law, it includes only residents. You follow me? So you must understand exactly what the law says. Every specific law is different, and they have their own definitions. To show you how critical the definitions are, how many people have heard of H.J.R. 33, you know, the Gold Act, 1933, H.J.R. 192, it is, H.J.R., when President Roosevelt recalled all the gold back in there? You go to the last page of the document, it gives definitions on the executive order. I always read the definitions. I always go read the definitions first so I understand what they're talking about. Most people don't. They take the definitions, page off, and they tear it off, put it over here, and they just publish the law. They don't give you the definitions. You go look to the book and look it up, and there's the definitions. Okay, it's in H.J.R. 192, it says, the term United States, when used in this law, includes the District of Columbia, the territories, Puerto Rico, Guam, Hawaii, and Alaska. The term continental United States includes the several states of the Union, Puerto Rico, Guam, etc. Okay? That's the definitions. Now you go read the law. Everybody in the United States must turn in their gold. My father did. He lived in Chicago. He never read the definitions. He's like anybody else. They'd never go read the definitions of the word. So he thought United States meant him too in Chicago, when in actuality he was within the continental United States because that's what the law said. But he misinterpreted. The newspaper said everybody's got to turn the gold who lives in the United States. Big headlines, turn in your gold, you know what I mean, get fined and everything. They did a marvelous scam there. They made you turn in the gold at $15 an ounce. 2 days later, after they collected all the gold from everybody, the deadline, they turned around and resold it back out for $33. Federal government made a lot of money there. Double their money, double their profit. They bought it at 15, forced everybody to sell at 15, and turned around and sold it back out at 33. That's a 1935, H.J.R. 192. But most people didn't study the law, you know what I mean? I didn't study the law. I didn't start studying the law until 1981. I've been doing it on a daily basis since. So when you have to understand the meanings of the words. And what is a state citizen? A state citizen has all the rights. He owes no allegiance to anybody except to the state. The state has to protect him in his property and his rights. He's not subject to the state's laws. Write this down here. Penal Code Section 228 and Penal Code Section 232. Get a 1994 version of the Penal Code. It's the dueling section. Right after I started using this section, they repealed these two sections, but it's still valid. It shows you the definition. 228 says, now listen very closely to what the terminology that the legislature used in writing this Penal Code. Every citizen who fights a duel cannot vote or hold public office. Section 232. Every person who fights a duel cannot vote or hold public office and has to go to jail for a year. Person and citizen are two different things. So once you understand that, I'm not a person. I may be a person as defined in 1789 or 1850, but I'm not a person as defined since under the 14th Amendment in 1868. That has a separate meaning. Yes. Yes. Because the definitions were intent there to show you the distinction between person and citizen. And they repealed, not because of the definitions, because the dueling law was no longer valid. Nobody fought a duel. They don't fight duels anymore.
They
haven't been valid. Yeah. You have to give them a copy of the Penal Code, and they'll say, well, it's been overturned. Yes, it's been overturned. I agree it's been overturned. But the definitions are still valid because it was overturned for other reasons that there's no more dueling. It's an antiquated law. You follow me?
Is that the only case that makes a distinction between the state between person and citizen?
That's one, and there's another one in the Argent case.
Argent.
Yeah, Argent. It's a government code, and in the government code is Argent, A-R-G-E-N-T. If you go in the up on the net, you can find it up on the net under California law, Argent. And there, the legislature made a big distinction. They rewrote the whole section to include person because it was excluded from. That's what the court said. So the legislature had to go back and rewrite the section. See, they know exactly what they're doing, but you have to be able to understand what they're doing, because if you don't understand what they're doing, you can't go anywhere. You're going to get slam dunked every single time.
What do you suppose would happen if you attacked the word person on the basis that the word is always defined using the word itself? That is to say, they will say person includes natural person, corporation, partnership, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Then I'd do the whole brief on based upon statutory construction. When a specific word is used in a definition, the general words assume the same definition as a specific word. Corporation is a legal entity, so therefore the natural person is a legal entity also.
But you attack it on the basis of a just in
generis. Yeah. Vague and ambiguous.
Yeah, because it includes the word on both sides of the definition.
Yeah, well, you can't define a word with a word.
You would think that you would be able to get a ruling simply on that. It's like saying a motor vehicle is a motor vehicle, or a deadly weapon is a deadly weapon. Well, I don't know what that means.
Yeah. Yeah, it'd be a harder argument. I'd rather do the ejusdem generis, you know what I mean? Argument. Because I got a lot on statutory construction.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, just as a logical concept, you don't say that a rose is a rose and then pretend that you've taught somebody something.
Yeah, well, the government does that all the time.
Yeah. Well, we let them get away with it.
Yeah. State government means state government. That's one side. The other side, state government means the government of the 50 states. That's the legitimate one. The fictional is state government means state government. Yes? What do you mean? Depends on what I want to do. See? It depends on what I want to do. Say I was going to bring a suit, I would bring it in, write this down, in the Superior Court of California. I would not bring it in the Superior Court of the State of California. The first one is the common law court, the second one's an equity court. Sure, go up to Westlaw or LexisNexis and put in the word common law, and you'll come. All the pleadings will come back, and they'll say the Superior Court of California. This case is based upon the common law filed in the Superior Court of California, 1995. You follow me? This case was based upon equity because it filed in the Superior Court of the State of California. See, the courts know exactly what you're doing. And they also have different headings. I got legal paperwork back from the California Supreme Court. Okay? It says, Supreme Court of the State of California, all block, all caps. Okay? On the envelope. And they got another envelope back from them, from the common law side of it. It says, Supreme Court of California, upper lowercase and old English fonts. So when you want to use the common law courts, you use Old English font, upper and lower case. You use all caps, you're now going into the equity court, into the fictional court. See, they did a roadmap for you, you know what I mean? You just have to be able to dig them out as you go along, you know what I mean? It takes time to consume. Time is consumed when you start going through all these different avenues trying to figure out where they've done. You know what I mean? Like when I used to have LexisNexis. No, I had Westlaw for a while. And I went up there and I did all that research. You know what I mean? Put California in, went into California cases and put common law in. And every court case they referred to, they come back and said, Superior Court of California, Superior Court of California, Superior Court of California. I think I got 11 or 12 cases in, say, the last 15 years. You know what I mean?
That's the total number of cases tried in the common law?
Yeah. Because most attorneys don't understand how to get to where they want to go. Yes?
What sort of cases are decided under common law? I tried to look it up once, and all I found was international.
Did you go up on the Westlaw?
No, not Westlaw.
Okay, go up on the Westlaw and pull up California section, California cases, and put in common law.
Well, I'm asking, what sort of cases are just...
there was a couple. Clyder was one of them, which is on my BBS. It's a common law case. It was being able to... It was a work-related injury, you follow me? And so they couldn't... they got fired for some reason or other. It was Clyder. And they said they had a remedy at the common law for illegal firing. You follow me? There's several different things, you know what I mean? I can't remember them all. It's been so long since.
So it'd be the same sort of cases that are decided under
statutory law.
It's just these people decided to do it under
the common law. Right.
And they knew what they were. They knew what direction they were going.
Right. And there was no provisions in statutory law to allow them to do what they wanted to do. So they pulled.
Okay. There's my question. Then what? Where are the cracks? Where the
It's an injury that occurs to you. It's not covered by the statutory law.
That's
that what you're looking for?
Yes.
Injury occurs to you that's not covered by statutory law. Now comes it falls under the common law. Yes.
Cases that you mentioned earlier where people were able to recover back taxes and Social Security, were those resolved in a common law court?
No, it was a court of equity. It's a court of claims in Washington, D.C. That's the only place it can be recovered, because the federal government is an equity thing. They have no common law. The federal government has no access to the common law. You can go into federal court and bring the state common law into federal court, but the federal government itself has no common law. Got numerous court cases on that. They do not have access to the common law. They only have access to, like the gentleman says, in rem seizures or equity proceedings, or writs of mandate to compel you to perform, you follow me? Under contract.
It's all contract.
Yeah, contract law. That's all they have. See, the federal government very, very narrow over here. And if you know how to keep them in that box, they'd like to jump all the way over here if you let them, you know what I mean? But if you know what their rules are, they have a very, very narrow tailor over here. In fact, they got a court case at home. It said, City and County of San Francisco again. It says all IRS seizures are in rem maritime seizures. So I don't worry about the IRS. I love the IRS. I feel sorry that they're going to get cut down. I hope they just abuse people more, because the more the IRS abuses people, the sooner people are going to wake up. Sometimes the people can only get woke up through their pocketbook. You know what I mean? I love the IRS. You know what I mean? The more they abuse people, the more I like it, because people are going to wake up. You know what I mean? Sometimes it's the only way you can wake them up is kick a man in the shins. You know what I mean? And they'll say, "What happened?" Yes.
So when you go to the local district, federal district court.
I never go to
I know you don't. But for an IRS case in rem,
right,
to ask for a libel to verify a lien, is that a good procedure to do?
No, because I would not go into well, say I had a lien against me, which I have, you know what I mean?
I'm sure.
Okay. I ain't got nothing. I don't own nothing.
That's
it's
right.
against the Social Security number, and I don't have a Social Security.
Go ahead.
And I don't have a Social Security number. But say if I didn't want to teach, you know what I mean? What I would do, the first thing I'd do, I'd write a bunch of letters and get them to admit a whole bunch of different things. Number one, admit that the lien attached to the Social Security number. Then I, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure 9C, 9. Go look it up. That's all Admiralty Maritime in rem seizures. They have a special section for in rem seizures, Admiralty rules. And they only allow three pleadings under Admiralty: complaint, answer, and rebuttal, and you can get discovery. And under that, there's only a bill of particulars is allowed, and you can get as many as you want. Federal rules, I have them at home. They're not published in most law books, federal civil procedure books. Rule 9 is not published. All it says, Admiralty rules, and they just skip it over one line. Whole section's dropped out. You have to go to some of the bigger law books to get it. But see, I would never go into federal court for any reason whatsoever unless they bring me in there. I have no business there. In fact, you cannot win any case against the Internal Revenue Service or the federal government in federal district court. Where can you win? State court or the Court of Claims?
To recovery.
Yes. Recovery of damages, you follow me? They take you and your money, they lien your house, they ruin your reputation, you can sue them for damages, anything else. I got several court cases where IRS has taken some property and they went to Court of Claims and they got it back. Go to federal district court and they lose. The federal district court does not have authority. What did I say? The federal district court does not have that authority. The federal district...
Because the Court of Claims is Article 3 in the...
No, Court of Claims is an Article 1. It's a constitutional recovery court. Designed for recovery from damages against the federal government. The federal district court is not, and they were never given that authority. That authority was strictly given to the Court of Claims.
State liens?
Huh?
So you get a state lien. Your remedy for a state lien would be in the common law court?
Yeah, in the Superior Court of California. But you have to do a bunch of letter writing first. Yeah. And you can do like some people do. That I've worked with. Get on the telephone. Let your fingers do the walking. Mr. Franchise Tax Board, this is not my number. This lien's attached to this number, and it's not my number. I can't do anything about it. Who's your supervisor? Mr. Supervisor, this is what? It's not my number. The lien attaches the number, but it attaches to my name. It doesn't attach to my name. It only attaches the number. Take the lien off. Remove the lien. I can't do it. Who's your supervisor? Walk your way up. You may have to go 5 levels, but eventually they'll remove the lien. We've done it. But you have to be persistent and argue. And if you wimp out and you're not, and they feel hear weakness or in your voice, you follow me, or you're unsure of yourself, you follow me, they're going to. Yes? Well, because the guy I did it wanted to get it done right now. He was selling a house and he had escrow money tied up and he wanted his money out of escrow, so he had to do it in a hurry.
And he's very good on the
phone. And he's very good, he knows how to talk, and he's very positive, you know what I mean? So when you're not positive and you don't have a good strong voice and not firm, you follow me, in your voice, do letter writing. That's why I recommend everybody do letter writing. You can be as firm as you want in letter writing. Because they can't see your weakness, you know what I mean? Unless you write a weak letter, you know what I mean? May I please? Yeah. Then you're going to be... How many people have a computer modem? You got a computer but no modem. No line. You can't go nowhere. I have here the Republic of Lomar, okay? It's a nation without land. They issue passports.
Republic of what?
It's a nation without land. They issue passports, and you can have ID, driver's license, everything else from them. Lomar. Okay, let me speak up closer here. She can't hear you. It's the Republic of Lomar. It's a nation without land. It's one of those micro states, and they issue passports, etc. Driver's license, ID cards, and etc. And I do have a couple applications up here, which I'm going to save for a few certain people. But if you have a computer modem, they have a website address, and you use me as a reference if you want. You know what I mean? And you can get it. Did you give him his letter, Phil? Did you give him his letter? I think it's, what, $89 for you, or $69 and $29 a year thereafter. And you have a second form of ID. Now you got a Republic of Lomar ID, you go into a bank and they say, I'd like to open a bank account. Let me see your ID. Here's my passport. Oh, I'm just visiting here. Okay, I'm living here. We can live any place we want. We're accepted any place. Oh, okay. And the United States does accept dual citizenship. www.republic-of-lomar.org.
L-O-M-A-R?
Yeah. And it's very interesting. Listen to what they say about themselves. They're a non-territorial sovereign nation focused on human rights, environmental protection, and personal privacy, protecting and serving thousands of citizens worldwide on human rights. So,
I was going to ask where they're from, but I guess they're not from anywhere.
No. They don't have a landmass. And they said they're just like the Vatican. The Vatican owns no land.
When the police officer asks you where exactly that nation is to be found,
it's on the internet.
On the internet.
It's on the web.
We're a nation without land. We're a roaming people. We have no land.
Gypsies.
Call your supervisor.
And if you're real smart, you do get one of these passports. Then you take a trip down to Mexico. You walk out of the immigration, have them stamp it out. Then when you come back in, have them stamp it in. Now, who's going to question it when the federal government recognizes it in and out?
Will they stamp it all the way back in?
Yeah, they have to. If they stamp you out, they have to stamp you in.
But don't you need a green card or anything, or a visa?
No, because you stamped out.
You stamp out on your way out?
Yes.
Has anybody done that?
Oh, from other passports we use. There's several different things you can do. But I'll lay this over here on the table. We're going to take a break for a few minutes here. And you can, people can come up here, write the address down, and glance at this, okay? We'll take a break about 10 minutes, and then we'll come right back. I need a cigarette.
Richard, did you not say that they offer driver's licenses?
Yes.
So there you go.
They have signed treaties with the United Nations. Okay. Ready? Okay. Welcome back after the break, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get back to what our original thought was. I was going to talk about citizenship only tonight, and I got off on a sidetrack talking law and everything else but citizenship. But that's me. And since we have a lot of new faces here tonight, I want you to go to the law library and ask them for the federal style manual. It's published in 1984, and still the federal government produces a style manual teaching people exactly how to use the words when they write laws. Anybody who writes laws for the government, they get a copy of this style manual. You know what I mean? Tells them how to use and, or, may, and everything else. You know what I mean? They're very educational if you know how to do it. And if you go to section 5.23, it says, listen to what the the federal government says, in designating the natives of the several states, the following forms will be used: Alabamian, Alaskan, Arizonian, Arizonan, Arkansan, Californian. So if the law doesn't say specifically Californian, it doesn't apply to you. Right in their laws, it tells them when you're referring to you and me. It says, and it, they tell them how to use the word. So you identify yourself according to their law. Yeah. No, the states have their own file manual. No, I don't have the copy of that yet. I'm looking for it. There's one available. I haven't found it yet.
You know it exists, though, right?
I know it exists.
Well hidden.
Well, see, anytime you have a government and they have a bunch of different people writing laws, they have a style manual so they know exactly how to write the laws and how to use the words properly. You follow me? See, every legislature gets a copy of this, so when he writes a law, he knows exactly what he's saying conforms with the law. So this is why they have these style manuals.
So every California legislator has one of those style manuals?
Right.
Read a section
on the food? No. I didn't want to get into that. Somebody asked me about allodial title. They're always asking me that. Here's a book you should go read so you'll understand what they did. How do you like living in the Atlantic Ocean? Let's see. No, the Pacific Ocean. You're living in the Pacific Ocean right now. The book is called Texas Real Estate Law, 5th edition, by Prentice Hall. Okay? And if you go back to page within the continental United States was predicated originally upon rock-solid land meridians. San Bernardino Meridian, Washington, D.C. Meridian, everything was based off the Washington, D.C. Meridian in 1785. Okay? Because Washington, D.C. was the capital. All the meridians started from the Washington, D.C. So in 1872, I think is when they changed this law here. Okay. Rather than using physical mountains based upon imaginary longitude and latitude lines. The stars, imaginary. So they move the meridian from a rock solid Washington, D.C. We're going to use this imaginary line over here, and we're moving all the land over here. So actually, we're out in the Pacific Ocean right now, according to the original, if you use that. But you have to describe your meets and bounds, longitude and latitude, based on the Washington, D.C. meridian. That puts you right back on the land again. That's what it was done in 1785. In 1872, they used the Greenwich imaginary line. A fiction, you know what I mean? So everybody's using the Greenwich longitude and latitude. You follow me? But when you have your surveyor survey your land out to do allodial rights to your property, you have to tell them that they have to use the Washington, D.C. meridian as designed in 1785.
What was that moment for repeating?
No. They just moved it over. 100 years later, nobody's even paid that attention to it. And they did a whole treatise on that, imaginary lines.
Real estate book?
Yeah. See, they always tell you the truth, but most people don't want to read.
What do they say about the imaginary lines in there? That it's
does you call it imaginary lines? Rather than have a solid monument, they use imaginary lines. Yes?
What if you're paying off land and you don't own it yet, but it's obviously described? Can you ask them to re-describe it, or you have to wait till you own
it? No, you can re-describe it now, then as soon as it's paid off, then you can move it in a lodeo. You'd have to have a surveyor.
The surveyor to re-describe it.
Yeah, you'd have to pay the surveyor and have him re-describe it using the Washington, D.C. meridian. Right, of re-describing the property with the correct meets and bounds. You follow me?
So, something referring to a township section and quarter sections, and that doesn't relate back to the meridian?
Originally it did. Originally it started out using the Washington, D.C. meridian. But in 1872, rather, they changed it over and used the Greenwich imaginary lines. Yes.
So if one was to update a land patent, it would be in one's best interest to have it have a surveyor come out and
re-describe it according to the Washington, D.C. meridian. But it's got to be paid for, and you better be a state citizen and know how to defend it. There's only one person I know that's got his land in allodial. He's got it completely in allodium in Colorado, and the sheriff won't even come on his property. Fishing game was chasing a poacher, and the poacher had shot a deer, and a deer ran onto his property, and the fishing game officer would not even come on his property to collect the carcass. He can't trespass on that land. They pulled all his records out of the county recorder's office and got him sealed in an envelope in the supervisor's desk so nobody else will see what he did. Yes?
So if this has been changed for over 100 years, basically, then what surveyor even knows what that is?
They all know. It's on the maps. Yeah. They never lie. It's just right there. You have to tell them. If you just say, I want it surveyed, meets and bounds, they're going to use the current one. But if you tell them you want to use a San Bernardino meridian, like it's what we use here, because that's a mountain, you follow me? Based on the San Bernardino meridian. Or anything on the other side would be using the Washington, D.C. meridian. Yes?
So in order to have allodial ownership of land, then it's sort of a geographic jurisdiction of the coordinate system you use to describe the land. You're saying here you need to use the Washington meridian.
Well, in California, you would use the San Bernardino meridian. Because the San Bernardino mountain doesn't move.
Most property meets and bounds still have that in it.
But they're using the Greenwich meridian.
Even though they call it San Bernardino meridian.
You're right. And there you see, there's not one square inch of land in America being taxed today. There's not.
Well, not sure, right?
No, they're not taxing one square inch of land. No, they're
taxing imaginary land.
Right. You know how they're taxing it? They're taxing assessor parcel lot number, a fiction. Subdivision plot number, which is all fiction. Everything has been changed. Meets and bounds can't be changed. You follow me? They remain the same. You know how they used to buy land in the old days? You pay, give the man gold, he reaches down and pick up a clump of dirt and hands it to you. And then you owned it. That was the bill of sale. That completed the transaction. He gave you dirt for gold.
Is there a requirement to have lawful money, gold or silver, change hands to purchase a loan?
Yes, you should. A portion of it should be. $1 plus other considerations. One.
You got to use $20 gold piece.
$20 gold piece.
The Coinage Act limits the debt settlement value of silver to $10. So you've got your.
Nobody is. Jim, it's $1 plus other considerations. I can give you a radio, a television, you follow me? It's $1 plus other considerations.
I personally would use a $20 gold piece.
Well, if I was going to do it.
Another consideration.
Yeah, well, if I was going to do it, buy some land and I had some money, what I would do, I'd use 1 troy ounce of gold plus other considerations. That gets away. How many people have heard about my people in Texas that I'm working with? Well, I'm working with 2 people down in Texas, okay? One guy says, I want to go in, register my car, and I don't want to pay any money. I said, okay, no problem. What you do is you walk into the DMV, and you tell them you traded an ounce of gold for it. So he walked in there and he says, I just traded for this truck. He said, I traded 1 ounce of gold for this truck. She says, well, how much is it worth? He says, 1 ounce of gold. What's the dollar value? It has no dollar value. I gave him an ounce of gold. And kept arguing that with the DMV. And finally they went and got the supervisor. He says, there's no dollar value, just an ounce of gold nugget I had. I gave it to him for this pickup truck. You know what I mean? There's no dollar value. The supervisor says, well, we've got to have a dollar value for the IRS. He says, I don't care what you got to have, but I only gave him an ounce of gold nugget for this truck. That's what I put on there, and I don't want to change. He says, okay, we'll register it. Gift. No charge. Second guy come along. He got an old jalopy. Want to change registration over to his name. He says, how do I do it? I said, well, what's it worth? He says, oh, a couple hundred dollars. I said, okay. You go into the DMV and tell him you traded him a police scanner for it. So we walked into the DMV, put on there, purchase price, 1 police scanner. Went through the same scenario and they gave him a free registration. Didn't have to pay. Registration and transfer fees.
Why would he want to register?
I don't know.
We looked up in the blue book and put their own finger down.
There's no blue book value, you know what I mean? I traded this police scanner that didn't work for this, you know what I mean? The car didn't work when I got it. I traded this police scanner didn't work for a car that didn't work, you follow me? I fixed it. He's going to fix this, you follow me? There's no blue book value. That's no value dollar. You put it there, you put anything else, you're falsifying government record. You stand there and argue it. Don't be a wimp. Buy my program. And I'll jump all over you. Right, David?
Right.
I jump all over you. You don't do it right, you know what I mean? I'll just keep after you do it right. Do it on your own. Have fun. Sink. When you wave your hand as you're going down for the 15th time. Richard, can you help me? I'll say, yeah. Take a deep breath. When you're 15 feet underwater. I show no mercy. But I got to have a little fun. But it's important that you understand the principles that I'm teaching you. You follow me? All I'm doing is teaching you principles of law that follow. And if you follow them correctly, with or without my help, I could care less. But you have to do your own research. Don't come crying to me. The principles of law are very, very simple. And they're always consistent. Where's this other one I was looking? Style manual. Everybody, right, we got a lot of new faces here tonight, so you got to put it right here. Write this down. I have to thank Steve. He's not here. Probably went home. Okay. It's Attorney General Opinion of California 97202. It's on my BBS. He's putting the pen back away. He knows about it. It's dated June 9th, 1997. Okay. This Attorney General Opinion states that the California has a Bailey interest in all automobiles that are registered. They have the right to ownership of them. They can take them. They put it right. They put these opinions right up on the internet, and you can get it. And the website is http://caag.state.ca.us/opinions. But just go in there, put go in the search engine, put California Attorney General, and you'll come right up to it. An opinion, as long as you know the opinion number, you get the rest is easy. 97-202.
Now, when you say that's an Attorney General opinion, does that mean that they're willing to try to enforce it, or it has the force of law?
It has the force of law. And you can have the court take judicial notice of it. There's no judge in his right mind will ever deny this because he's going against the Attorney General, Daniel E. Lundgren. Yes?
Why would you want the judge to take judicial notice of that?
Well, my car's not registered, so therefore he has no... See, you do the argument over here to prove your point over here. So when he gets over there, you slap him over here, and then slap him over here, make him jump back and forth. You make him jump through the hoops.
If you don't have a license, can you drive a car without, that is registered?
Pardon?
If you do not have a California license, can you drive a car that is not that is registered?
Sure, as long as you don't get caught.
What happens if they do catch you?
Then you have to address the issue. As long as it's not registered to you, you've got a fair chance of winning.
Use determines.
Classification.
Was commercially at that time.
So. Right. The household goods argument. Yes.
I have a 1977 Dodge van, and I recently found out that the DMV doesn't have they destroyed the certificate of origins between 76 and 77 as they were committing certificates of origin to microfilm.
Right.
And so I requested the a copy of the certificate of origin, and I got a phone call from the DMV stating that they don't have a record of it. So I asked them if they'd use the money order that I sent them to send me something that indicates that they don't have a certificate of origin anymore. So I'm expecting to get that back. In addition to the bill of sale that I have from the guy that I originally purchased the van from 2 years ago, I tracked the guy down, went over with a new bill of sale and a silver dollar, which he accepted, signed the form, and this is what I carry around with me now. And is that about as close to a complete title as one can get?
I don't know.
Why, but...
Mm-hmm. I know, but I'm not going to tell you. Go research it. But let's get back to citizenship here. I keep getting back and I get drug off here. Every time somebody asks me a question, I get all off to the side here. You know what I mean? This is 1879 case, okay? Lance versus Randall. A state cannot make a subject of a foreign government a citizen of the United States. This can only be done by the mode provided by the naturalization laws of Congress. Congress was given the power under the Constitution to create naturalization laws. Uniform naturalization laws. They were not given the power to naturalize anybody. They were not authorized under the Constitution to have any citizens at all. They have no land. They were only authorized to make the laws. The states would do all the naturalization in the mode provided. So they would naturalize state citizens. The states were doing all the naturalization up till 1950, in the 1950s, 52, 53, somewhere around there. And all the state courts quit doing the naturalization, turned all their naturalization process over to the federal government. So now they're only, and they were asking you at the naturalization process up till 1972, they were asking you, do you want to become a U.S. citizen or a state citizen? And everybody said, well, I want to be a citizen of everything. So everybody became a U.S. citizen, so they quit asking them. But the provisions are still there, and there's still provisions in state court for the states to naturalize them in Title VIII. But you got to force them to do it. And I'm looking for a good, strong litigator who wants to become a state citizen. Who's German, England, somebody who understands the law. You know what I mean? Been here for a long time, you know? And we're going to go into state court and make the state start doing what they're supposed to be doing. I tried to work with a couple different people. And I got through the first step and the second step with them, then they wimped out on me. It's a long, drawn-out process, you know what I mean? But you've got to, the laws are there, and we just can't do everything, you know what I mean? I can't do anything by myself. It requires more than one people. Like him doing something, him doing something, him doing something. Everybody's got to do a little something so we can all work collectively to put this state back to where it belongs. And it's very easy to do because the laws say we can do it. Write this court case down. This is the most important court case. It's never been overturned. Ex parte Frank Knowles, 5 Cal 300. Read it over very thoroughly, and you'll see the limits of the federal government. It's been distinguished out after the 14th Amendment, but it's never been overturned. It's been objected to, you know what I mean? But it's never been overturned. It's still valid law. I did an argument on a radio talk show with a college professor over this, you know. And he said, well, you're using old state law. I says, well, using old state law is what state has never been overturned. It's still valid. The United States Supreme Court goes all the way back to the Magna Carta. One time it went back to the 12th century in one of their pleadings. So they use old law. And they say, well, that's old law. Then you turn around and ask them, you know what I mean? Court cases have an expiration date? No court case has an expiration date, and very rarely are court cases ever overturned. They're distinguished out and reinterpreted, but they're never overturned. You got one court case that says, every citizen has a right to build a home on his own land. And you got another court case that says, no resident has the right to build a home on his own property. Did this one, this is a newer case, did this one overturn this one? No, because this one's talking about resident, which is an alien, and property. This one's called citizen and land. They use the right terminology. See, so once you understand the sequence of events and the right terminology, you're home free. See, here, 1883, after the 14th Amendment, listen to what the court said. This is McDonnell, M-C-D-O-N-E-L, versus State. May 1883, 90 Indiana, 320. Repeating, 90, Indiana, 320. The evidence of bushing on his voir dire showed that although he was not a citizen of the United States, he was a citizen and a voter of the state under Section 2 of Article 2 of our state constitution. One may be a citizen of a state and yet not be a citizen of the United States. And they said this in 1966, Crossey versus Board of Elections, electors. There's a whole This is this one, Sharon versus Hill, 1885. Okay, it's a long site, but it's 26 Fed 337. Repeating, 26 Fed 337. Listen to what, I'm just gonna read a little short paragraph here. The 14th Amendment does not make a resident in a state a citizen of such state, unless he intends by residence therein to become a citizen. Citizenship and residence, as often been declared by the courts, are not controvertible terms. One are not the same as the other. Citizenship and residence. Remember the first thing I did in elementary elements of law, you know what I mean? Right back here, 1885, saying the same thing, you follow me? Citizenship or residence. If you have a residence, you're an alien. I don't have a residence, I have a home. Legal distinction being made. So be very wary of your words that you use. Because if you use the wrong words, like the cop's gonna ask you, right off the bat, where's your residence? I don't have a residence, I have a home. And he said, well, that's a residence. I'm sorry, sir, but for legal purposes, residence has a different meaning than a home. So I just want you to know, because I'm going to ask you this when we get on the witness stand. Okay.
Something that I haven't been able to resolve is the 14th Amendment itself, the last few words of the amendment say he'll be a citizen thereof, of the state. And I don't understand, how do the two resolve?
There's a second class citizen.
So we're talking about is
four classes of citizens here in America.
Was the federal state created before that?
No, they were a second-class citizen within the state under the protection of the federal government.
Yeah, it still doesn't resolve.
Here's another good one. Wadley versus Newhall. W-A-D-L-E-I-G-H versus Newhall. 1905, same year I was born. The rights, privileges, and immunities which the 14th Amendment for its affordments were designed to protect are such as belong to citizens of the United States as such, and not for citizens of a state. So a state citizen has no civil rights. Title 42 doesn't apply to any state citizen. It's very simple, 1905. Got a whole, Maxwell versus Dole, you know what I mean? There's thousands of court cases that say what we are. Citizenship and domicile are substantially synonymous. Okay? So when they took out domicile of the word out of California law and called it residence, replaced it with the word residence, making everybody a resident alien. Remember we said that earlier in the law. So when you are a U.S. citizen, you are a resident alien in California. And how many people have researched the 1040 income tax return?
A little bit.
Okay. The 1040 income tax return is the same as the 2255 foreign earned income. Because you're in the country of California, and you have to, as foreign earned income. I can prove that, U.S. v. Slater. It's a court case. Come to my house tomorrow. Every Sunday, I have a free seminar at my house. You're welcome to come there, and starts at 12 noon, it goes till 3 o'clock. I'll give you 42 laws, show you a few videos, and educate you, and let you go home and read and weep. You know what I mean? Feel sorry for yourself. You know what I mean? I got no problem with that. See? Here's 1949.
Want to give your phone number for the audio tape?
Oh, for the audio tape? Yeah. My phone number at home, if you call me in the morning after 9, I'll be glad to give you directions on how to get to my house. The phone number is area code 818-703-5037. I'll give you directions out into my house. It goes from 12 noon to 3 o'clock. And it's every Sunday I have one. So please call me and I'll give you directions. This is Alla versus Cornfield, 1949. ALLA versus Cornfield. The site on it is 84 FedSup 823. 84 FedSup 823. Listen to what the court said. Don't argue with me, argue with the court. There is a distinction between citizenship of the United States and citizenship of a particular state, and a person may be the former without being the latter. To be a citizen of a state, so as to sue or be sued in the courts of the United States, the persons must have a domicile in each state. If a person establishes his domicile in a foreign country, he loses his state citizenship, but not necessarily his United States citizenship. So
which citizenship are they referring to? Citizenship under the 14th Amendment?
You'd be protected under your passport.
But not a 14th Amendment system.
Yeah. You'd be under the original Constitution. If you're a state citizen, then you would lose it. See, they try to think like people, most people don't understand. There are two citizens of the United States. Which one are you talking about? The one in the Constitution or the one under the 14th Amendment? Always ask for clarification. Are you a citizen of the United States? I might be. Depends on who's asking, what, which law you're referring to, which one, where, what circumstances. You know what I mean? If I'm out of California in Germany, I would be a citizen of the United States. But as long as I'm in California, I'm not a citizen of the United States, as defined in the original Constitution, because I'm not subject on a citizen of the United States under the 14th Amendment. You see how they've used the same words to mean multiple things and thereby confusing everybody right down the line. So once you understand, you have to ask questions. Remember, I keep telling you, always ask questions. Okay. Here's 1953. Listen to what the court said in 1953. They repeated the same paragraph again in 1997. Kitchens versus Steele, 1953. The site on it is 112 FedSup 383. A citizen of the United States is a citizen of the federal government and of the state in which he resided, and one possessing such double citizenship owes allegiance and is entitled to protection from each sovereign to whose jurisdiction he is subject. So you're subject to both laws, state and federal. But as a state citizen, you're not subject to federal law because you're only subject to the state law. They're always consistent. They always say, citizen of federal government, where's the land? See, See, the courts never lie. They always tell you the truth when they write these opinions. But one of the key things is, we don't understand, even I'm guilty, I have to admit. I was guilty of not understanding what they were saying. I used emotion while reading some of these laws, you know what I mean? I thought they mean this, I thought they meant that, which is wrong. Yeah, you know what the word assume means, you know what I mean? Then when you research the definitions, then it's totally different.
What's the 1997 case that you just...
Jones versus Temer.
Oh.
I give that out tomorrow. Now here, 1984. Now listen to the terminology used by the court in 1984. A citizen of a state within the meaning of the diversity statute is a person domiciled within that state who is a citizen of the United States. They're talking about the 14th Amendment citizen, you follow? 1984. So you have to understand, well, I'm not a... See, like, I would be, say I was going to take him in, he's a good U.S. citizen. I'm going to take him in the federal court. I could take him in the federal court on the diversity. He's a citizen of the United States and I'm a state citizen. That's the diversity. You follow me? And I could bring him up under common law, state common law, because he's a U.S. citizen. And under the diversity clause. See, when you use the diversity clause, you can bring the state constitution into court. And state constitution is common law in federal court. See, the federal court has no common law. Only the state citizen can bring it in through the state constitution. See, you're the master of your own pleadings. You follow me? The master of your case. The way you set up your case is the way it goes through down the line. If you don't follow through, you're okay. You lose. Got no problem with that. Here's another one. As a general rule, it is presumed, until the contrary is shown, that every person is a citizen of the country which he resides. Further, citizenship, once granted, is presumably retained unless voluntarily relinquished, and the burden rests upon one alleging a change of citizenship and allegiance to establish the fact. That's why when we do our citizenship, we do oath of allegiance and etc. You know what I mean? To establish that we took our allegiance otherwise. You follow me? I took my allegiance to California. How many people pledge allegiance to the American flag? Especially when you're a kid. We all did. Heil Hitler. Pledged allegiance to Germany too, you know what I mean? Because that's what you did, basically, you know what I mean? Pledged allegiance to the federal government. That's why I never have an American flag in my house. I had a friend of mine just recently up in Kansas, the IRS came in and raided his house. He says, I'm a state citizen. He hadn't done my program, so he didn't know everything. So he calls me up crying. He says, they walked in my house, they kicked my front door, and I had 50 armed Gestapo agents here at my house, and just ranting and raving, you know, and... I told them I was a state citizen, you know, and they said, what's their jurisdiction? And he says, you gave us jurisdiction. He says, how did I do that? He says, see that American flag flying in your window? That gave us jurisdiction to come into this house.
California flag, would that...
That would stop the feds from coming in.
To be doing this, then?
Yeah.
California flag.
the original California flag. The government state flag, not the government flag. There's two flags in California. One government flag that the feds can use and want you to use, and the original flag, the state flag, which they can't touch. So it depends on what you want to use. You know what I mean? If you don't know the difference, go look it up in the law book. What's it called? The Flag Book of America. It tells you right in there. Yes?
When you see like hospitals or anything, you always see the federal flag over the state flag.
Right.
What are the implications to that?
Yeah, that indicates that's under federal control.
It's not saying that is federal property, though.
It's under federal control. See, there's two sets of laws in every books, one for U.S. citizen, one for state citizen. And you have to know the difference. If you don't know the difference, we're hurting. Okay. Gwen has a little story she wanted to tell, so I'm going to ask her to get up and stretch her legs here and walk up here. This is Gwen Wyckoff, a friend of mine from years ago. I was trying to teach her citizenship, but you know, it's hard, you know, when... Yes.
He's got a nice, cushy chair up here. This is very nice. I told him that when he ran out of wind, I would tell a story.
He didn't run out of wind yet. I can still go strong. I got this much more to go.
Oh, okay. All right. Once upon a time, I was a U.S. citizen, and I rescinded my Social Security number. And for those of you who've done this, you know that the federal government and the state government do not like to let go easily. So we often have little creatures come and knock on our doors and harass us. Because I went through Richard's program, every piece of paper that ever could be filed had been filed properly. And I had written a 14 or 15 page document to the Franchise State Tax Board outlining every little possible detail about my status. So lo and behold, the telephone rang one day. And we have a security gate downstairs. Security gates, by the way, are excellent. I can't recommend them highly enough. So Frank, my roommate, answered the phone and said, they said, "Is Miss Wyckoff there? This is the California State Franchise Tax Board, and we want to speak with her." And so Frank said, "Well, hold on." And so he told me, he said, "They're down there waiting for you." And I said, "Frank, do you want to be my witness?" And he said, "Oh, yes." And so we went down and, of course, spoke to the agent on the street. You know, you never let them into your house. And she had this great big computer printout. It was about that thick. I guess she was going all day long harassing people. And she said, "You have not paid your taxes." And I said, "I don't believe that your agency has answered my correspondence." And she said, "You are a tax protester." I said, "I am not a tax protester. You have not answered the documentation." I said, "Don't you have it there? Didn't your boss send you over with the documentation? I'd really like to have an answer." And she got kind of nervous, and she was looking through this great big computer printout. She says, "Well, I don't have any documentation." I said, "You mean you didn't come here to answer my letter?" And she said, "No, I guess not." And I said, "Let me tell you something. Somebody in your agency is out to get you. They wanted you to be embarrassed." And I said, "You must not have friends in high places. They would never send you out to harass me." And then she tried to get off the subject. She said, "But you're a tax protester." I said, "I told you I am not a tax protester. And I want an answer to my letter. And I thought you were here to give me an answer." And she said, "Well, I don't have it." And I said, "Do you want to have a copy of the letter that I created?" And she said, "Yes, I do." She gave me her card, and I said, "This is going to cost you, lady. You are wasting my time." So she went away all in a huff, and Frank was there as a witness, and I billed her $150 for my time. She didn't pay it, but, you know.
See, if you do your paperwork right, that's what I've been saying from time day one, always do everything by paperwork, you know what I mean? Because you're going to get very nervous at the last minute. Do you follow me? And try to understand that you're the boss. And Gwen feels empowered, you know, once, like the Board of Equalization, harassing her for some stuff. And I said, well, ask them for pay. Tell them you won't refuse to volunteer your services and you want to get paid for collecting taxes, sales tax. So she wrote and asked for an appointment as a tax collector, asked him how much he was going to get paid. They never did answer, did they? They left her alone. Because if you ask for it, you know what I mean? They can't give it to you, you follow me? And you're not going to volunteer your services. They don't volunteer their services. So ask for it, you know what I mean? What it is, you know what I mean? You're a businessman, ask for your appointment, you know what I mean? As a tax collector, you know? And they refuse to give it to him. Well, they refuse to give me an appointment. I asked for it. Here's my letter. And I don't volunteer my services. I told him I would collect, and this is the pay I wanted. I told him I would collect their taxes, but I would bill them $150 an hour for collecting taxes and maintaining books and records for them. If they want to pay me, fine. If they don't, that's okay. I won't do it. But put the burden back on them. I don't know how many people around here like to push wheelbarrows full of rocks uphill. I don't like to push wheelbarrows full of rocks uphill. I like to take the rocks out of my wheelbarrow, put it in the government's wheelbarrow, and I go uphill with an empty wheelbarrow and let them push all the rocks. Take the rocks out of your wheelbarrow and put it in theirs. And once you learn how to do that, they're going to leave you alone, basically. They're going to send you a letter, harass you a little bit now and then. But learn how to ask questions, write letters. Because it's the government's job to answer your questions, and they don't like to answer questions. I got a bunch of good questions I like to ask, you know what I mean? But they won't put me in a position where I can ask them. So I got to find other people to ask them. Let's get back to citizenship now. I thought that was kind of a change of pace there to give you a thing. Okay. U.S. versus Gross, 1960. One of the things the government has a burden of proving in a criminal case is venue. And without the proof of such essential part of the government, case, there can be no conviction. Motion for acquittal made at the conclusion of all the evidence properly raised the question of venue in criminal case. So once they present all their evidence, then you move for a motion for acquittal. If it's denied, no problem, you can take it up on appeal. But you've laid the foundation. And that's what I teach you. So once you join my program, you have access to the back end of my BBS. I have over 300 pleadings available to you right now that you can modify to fit your own circumstances, whatever it may be. You know what I mean? When you walk into court, you file 30 judicial notices already pre-made. You know what I mean? All you have to do is modify them, fit your circumstances.
They don't like that.
I know.
I've heard them squeal like pigs about that.
Yes. They don't like that because they got to do their work, you know what I mean? They want the job, let them do the work. Here you are again, 1966. Listen to what the court said, and then I'll explain what the court said. Right to vote in federal elections is conferred by federal constitution. I don't vote in federal elections. I only vote in state elections. You follow me? Legal distinction being made. You have to understand, you know what I mean? Once you understand that everybody thinks everybody is under the 14th Amendment, we're all not. the 14th Amendment doesn't apply to everybody. Got numerous court cases to say it. It's a draft law case I'm going to use in Texas. Brady versus U.S. Everybody knows that. Waiver of constitutional rights not only must be voluntary, but must be knowing, intelligent acts done with sufficient awareness of the relevant circumstances and likely consequences. That's Brady versus U.S. 397 U.S. 742. 397 U.S. 742. How many people were told when they got their driver's license and they were now doing waiving up all their rights, giving up all their rights, that they're now a resident alien in the state when you got your driver's license? I was never told that. And you can prove that as a commercial license very easily. Become a taxi cab driver, you don't have to have a chauffeur's license anymore. A regular driver's license is sufficient. You used to have a chauffeur's license, a commercial license, and an operator's license. There was three. So in 1959, they rolled them all into one. So if you're a taxi cab driver, you have a regular driver's license that allows you. That's commercial. Sheriff versus Cullen. Everybody knows this court case. It's an old one. All the Patriots quoted. There can be no sanctions or penalty imposed on one because of his exercise of his constitutional rights. They're going to try. You know what I mean? But I have state constitutional rights, and I can't. But they're going to try because they don't want the slaves out of the pen. Here's a good one that I really like. Remember I said earlier, anytime you sign a W-4, it's an admission you work for the federal government? Now here's one that says basically the same thing. Expression of political belief is not a defense to supplying false information on withholding exemption order. You cannot ever sign a W-4 under any circumstances. To do so throws you right back in the sheep pen. There's so many good cases here. You know what I mean? I could go on for a whole week just in this one book. The 14th Amendment restrictions on the powers of the states do not apply to the federal government. The restrictions in the 14th Amendment only apply to the states. The 14th Amendment does not apply to the federal government. What does apply to the federal government? Yeah, the Fifth Amendment. The restrictions of the Fifth Amendment, the federal constitution applies to the federal government. We got a court case. Hollingsworth versus Illinois. Or Hollis versus Illinois. I can't remember. It's off the top of my head. I'm good, but not that good. Anyway, it's about 1992 or 93 court case. Anyway, there's a guy in Illinois got convicted of murder. And he had an all-white jury. So he appealed to the United States Supreme Court under the Fifth Amendment, saying he was denied due process. To have an all-white jury convict him was a violation of the Fifth Amendment. And the United States Supreme Court said there, right in the pleadings, right in their court rules, in their opinion, stated that under the Fifth Amendment, having an all-white jury is not a violation of the Fifth Amendment, and we cannot reverse under that. But had the plaintiff come up here under the 14th Amendment, we would have reversed this decision. See, they know the limits they can go on each one, you know what I mean? Over here is Constitution, over here anything they want to make it under the 14th Amendment. You follow me? So under the Fifth Amendment, they can't do anything. That's what the court said. There was a big newspaper article on it. I got all the newspaper articles and everything. I thought that was funnier than heck. It was the same way with when they cut the jury down from 12 to 6 people in Florida. Guy went up, Florida cut the jury to save money. They cut the jury from 12 people down to 6 people. And the guy appealed. He says he was denied due process because they only had 6 jury members in the jury. He says, under the 14th Amendment, I was denied due process. And the court says, no, under the 14th Amendment, you can have as little as 3 people sitting on the jury. But he didn't go up under the state constitution. He didn't go up under the Fifth Amendment. He went up under the 14th Amendment, and the court come back with a ruling based on the 14th Amendment. So do you see what I'm trying to explain to you? You know what I mean? It depends on, you ask the right question, you get the answer for that question. If you ask the wrong question, you get the wrong answer for the wrong question. You know what I mean? They're going to answer just whatever you ask them. You know what I mean? Well, it's 10 o'clock, and let's adjourn up to the restaurant, and we will have coffee and dessert up there, and we'll chat some more, and I'll talk to anybody who wants to talk to me up there. We'll have coffee and dessert. We have to be up there so we can clean the room here. And thank you very much for coming here, ladies and gentlemen, and enjoyed it. Anybody wants to make an extra donation at the door, that tape's off, right?
I'd appreciate it.
He's trying to weasel out.
I know he is. He's trying to be a...